Good morning, Denver Community Church. It is great to be gathering with you as we explore and participate in the life of Jesus so that we can be a healing presence in our world. Now, I don't know how it's already here, but this is Christmas week. Now, while we will absolutely miss seeing you at our Uptown building for our normal Christmas Eve gatherings, we are really looking forward to having you tune in for the DCC Christmas Special. That's right. This Thursday at 4 p.m., we will be airing a full-blown Christmas special complete with comedy, music, content for the kids, a message, and of course, a very special rendition of Silent Night. You can tune in with us live on Facebook, YouTube, or our website. Now, as a reminder, today is the last Sunday that we'll be gathering together in 2020. We will not have any gatherings next week on December 27th, and we hope you, along with our staff, will be able to find rest and rejuvenation as we end our year and then look forward to celebrating the new year together on Sunday, January 3rd. Now, finally, I invite you to give financially today. Each year, we continue to be incredibly grateful to see all of the ways that you invest in our faith community with your time, your talent, and your finances. And this is how a community of faith should function, where each of us invests what we can in whatever season we are in to see the connection, community, gathering, serving, and mission that we are called to collectively make happen. As we come to the end of the year, we ask that you consider making a year-end gift. We literally cannot do all that we do without your investment and support. You can give this morning through our app or by texting Denver Church to 77977. Thank you for your generosity. It's a gift to be with you today. I invite you to take a deep breath and find your grounding as we continue with our time of worship and explore the sacredness of Christ and God's love for us.
Peace. Hi, we're the McDaniel family, and today we'll be reading from John 14:27.
Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. You do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
Today we light the candle of peace as we look toward the birth of Christ. May we remember these words from his final days in offering his peace to his disciples. Jesus defines peace saying, do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. As our words feels crazy in this season, creating fear and troubling our hearts at every turn, we know that the peace that Christ offers us is with us here and now. His gift to us is to rest in his knowledge that he has redeemed and is redeeming all things. He is redeeming our fear, he is redeeming our pain, he is redeeming his loss, he is redeeming our worry. When God is at work, there is peace to be found, and that defies the turmoil of our circumstances. Do not let your hearts be troubled, do not be afraid.
God, help us to breathe in your peace in this season. In a year that has felt anything but peaceful, you remind us that you have given your peace to us, not as the world gives, but as you give, without condition and forever ours. Though the conditions of our world today seek to rob us of that peace, we know that what you have given cannot be taken away. May our hearts find rest in that gift in this season of Advent. Amen.
Well, again, it is so good to be together this morning. Would you turn to someone next to you and speak grace and peace over them now?
Hello, everyone. It's good to be together today on this, the final Sunday of Advent. If you'd like to follow along today, we will be reading from Luke chapter 2. Now, if you've been with us during the season of Advent, you know we've been exploring this idea of Emmanuel, God with us. And today we want to explore just how God entered into this world, how God put on flesh and dwelled among us. And I want to spend some time on this because even though we know the story, and maybe even because we know the story so well, our familiarity with it may actually keep us from contemplating the power of this holy day. So with that said, I'll begin reading in Luke chapter 2 with verse 1. Luke writes this: "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." Now, I think what Luke tells us bears repeating. He writes, "The time came for the baby to be born, and Mary gave birth to her firstborn, a son." Which means in this story that we just read, Jesus is a baby. He is tiny infant Jesus. Now, I know this is obvious, but right here in this telling of the story, Jesus has just been born. And by the way, if you have ever seen a baby in the minutes following the birth, they are, they look odd, which is putting it mildly. Now, I'm sure that there are some parents listening or watching thinking, "No way, not my baby. They were adorable." Okay. If by adorable you mean something that resembles a naked alien who just emerged from its birth pod covered in slimy fluids, then I couldn't agree more. I mean, the only people who think their brand new baby is adorable are the parents, which means at this moment in Bethlehem, the only person who thought Jesus was adorable would have been Mary, because according to the Gospels of Matthew and Luke, Joseph is not his father. All that to say, in this story, Jesus is that bizarre-looking creature that has this like sagging skin that appears to be two sizes too big, who has the twig-like appendages that are reaching and kicking out into the cool air. His eyes are moving about in all directions like a tree frog, and his head is probably shaped like a cone because of going through the birth canal. He's a newborn. He's brand new. The only thing that Jesus can do in this story is what any newborn can do. He can cry, poop, sleep, poop, eat, and poop. That's it. Now, I point all this out because for many of us, Advent and Christmas have become familiar. We know the story well. We've heard these words in Luke chapter 2 more times than we can count. We are familiar with the season of Advent and Christmas. We are well acquainted with the nativity scene, so much so that many of us have nativity sets in our houses. And you know how they are. I mean, there's Mary, and then there's Joseph, and they're placed on opposite sides of the manger, and they're both gazing with this affection on their dear 8-pound, 6-ounce newborn infant Jesus. The shepherds are off to one side, and they're enjoying the moment. And often one of the shepherd figurines has a sheep on his shoulders as he looks at Jesus. And the magi, the wise men, they're off to the other side holding their gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And around all of them, their animals are scattered. And they're positioned in such a way that suggests that they almost have a sense or some sort of understanding about what's going on. And then right in the middle, there's Jesus. And he is just perfect with his angelic smile. Like, he's so perfect in our collective psyche that one songwriter, who obviously has never been around infants, wrote the lyric, "The little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes." Oh, and then there's like the star that's shining down on the scene of all of them. This day, this scene, this season, it is so familiar to us, more than the nativity. We sing the songs, we decorate the trees, we wrap the gifts, we hang the tinsel. We do this every year. We know it. We get it. We've heard it all before. And with all of our familiarity, this holy day can very well be something in which we lose something. And I say that because familiarity is the enemy of wonder. When something becomes commonplace, we lose amazement and awe. Something that once captured our minds and hearts and attention can soon become ordinary. I mean, consider the way many of us go about our days. Like, we barely notice that we live on the edge of the miraculous every waking moment. We move about in a world that is aflame with a numinous presence. We live in a place that is saturated in beauty. We have our being in a universe that pulses with the divine life and breath. And yet, how often would any of us say that we are caught up in wonder? Like, when was the last time that you would say you were filled with awe? It's possible this doesn't happen often because we become familiar with our world. And because of that, it no longer produces wonder. So we walk around and we miss what's right in front of us. For example, trees. And you're like, trees? Yeah, so? I mean, they're nice and the leaves are pretty in autumn. Like, well, hang on a second. Trees are unreal. These beings communicate with each other in a way that the brightest minds can't even explain. They share resources with one another across species, and when they communicate, they can send signals that warn each other of danger. So if there's like an invasive species of insects destroying one tree, it will sound an alarm, and nearby trees will secrete fluids that smell bad and taste bad to keep the insects away. Oh, and there are more trees on this planet than there are stars in the Milky Way galaxy. And what about honeybees? Honeybees are known to communicate with one another about the location of flowers or of a good place to build a nest. And the way they communicate is by dancing, which means there is no such thing as a honeybee that is Baptist. Now, not only do they communicate, they're also known to disagree with each other. Scientists have observed that if one worker bee is in favor of a particular location, they do what they call the waggle dance, which is a very scientific term. And if another worker bee disagrees, they will headbutt the bee who is doing the waggle dance like a Scottish martial artist. And then there's the Cape buffalo, who happen to be Democratic. When it comes time for the herd to move, the females, or cows, vote on it by pointing their head in a particular direction and then laying down. And only mature females are allowed to vote. And whichever direction gets the most votes, meaning when the majority of cows are facing in one direction, that's the direction the herd goes. And nobody knows how this is started or who made up the rules or how they know which direction to go or who has the most votes. But this is how Cape buffalo move together. Then there's time. Time is something we all experience every single day, but time itself is an illusion. Einstein said, "The distinction between the past, present, and future is only a stubbornly persistent illusion," which means time is not constant. And we can experience it as it speeds up and slows down, meaning we don't always experience time the same way. For example, if you work in a high-rise office building that on the 34th floor, time for you moves faster than it does if you were on the ground because of something called gravitational time dilation. Simply put, it means the closer you are to the ground, the slower time moves because gravity there is stronger. So it stands to reason if you're running up against a deadline and running out of time, just get closer to the ground. Now, of course, we experience all of these things on this planet that we call Earth. And by the way, no one actually knows who first called this planet Earth. The name itself means dirt, which is an interesting name for a planet that is more than 70% water, but I digress. Our planet is hurtling through infinite space at a speed of 67,000 miles per hour. Now, of course, the Earth is a part of the solar system, and our solar system orbits around the center of our galaxy at roughly 490,000 miles per hour. And as fast as that may seem, it takes our solar system somewhere between 225 and 250 million years to take just one lap around the Milky Way. And while your head might hurt as you contemplate the sheer size of the Milky Way, keep in mind our galaxy is one of nearly 2 trillion galaxies in our universe. And to help us understand how many 2 trillion is, 2 trillion seconds is 63,418 years. And as massive as 2 trillion is, it's still 1.3 trillion less than our national deficit and more than 25 trillion less than our national budget or debt. But we are talking about galaxies, not dollars. Now, these 2 trillion galaxies are all at home in our universe that is constantly expanding. And as the universe expands, it brings more existence into being, which means there's more universe today than there was yesterday. So we can confidently say our universe is still being created. And physicists believe this is but one universe among a giant multiverse. And not long ago, two physicists estimated the number of universes in the multiverse at a humongous number. They said the number is so high that they suggested humans are limited in trying to understand the number itself because the number is more than all the information any one individual human brain can absorb in a lifetime. They contend there are more universes in existence than the human brain can make sense of, observe, or distinguish. I mean, seriously, we live in the midst of the miraculous every single moment. And yet, as we say these things like, I'm bored, there's nothing to do, this is not interesting. Is it possible that we've become a little bit too familiar with our world? Is it possible that few things have the power to catch our attention anymore, let alone lead us toward wonder? This way of becoming familiar, it works in another way too. Think about a song, any song. Like you hear the first few chords of the song and it instantly brings you back to a moment where you remember exactly where you were the first time you heard it. One of those songs for me is Smells Like Teen Spirit by Nirvana. Now I first heard it in late 1991. I was 15 years old and I was driving my sister and I to school. Yes, I drove us to school when I was 15, so my sister, who was 16 and had her license, could do her makeup on the way to school. So we would pull out of the driveway, we'd wave goodbye to our unsuspecting mother, drive down our road, and at the stop sign when we were out of her sight, we would switch spots and I would drive. And yes, my parents know now, but only recently found out about this. Anyway, I'm driving, the song comes on, and my sister says, have you heard this song? And she turned it up, and I couldn't believe it. Like I had no words. It was like nothing I had ever heard. It was that moment when you have an experience of something that feels real and tangible and concrete, but you cannot explain it. Moments that break up the familiar, and they cement into our memory. I mean, I remember everything about that moment in 1991. I was wearing a blue, orange, and green color block, long sleeve polo shirt, and acid wash jeans. I was driving a white 1988 Ford Taurus with navy blue cloth interior, and my sister and I were just pulling up to the corner of Pettus Road and Knapp Street in Grand Rapids, Michigan. But like everything else, over time, the song became familiar. Like today, I can't tell you where I was the last time I heard that song, or even the last time I heard that song. This is what happens when we become familiar, when things move from novel to routine. We miss them. We don't see them. They fail to catch our attention. Now, there's no need for guilt. I mean, it seems actually that this is a part of the human condition. The philosopher and psychologist William James observed this very thing almost 130 years ago in his work, Principles of Psychology. And James wrote these words, "In youth, we may have an absolutely new experience, subjective or objective, every hour of the day. Apprehension is vivid, retentiveness strong, and our recollections of that time, like those of a time spent in rapid and interesting travel, are of something intricate, multitudinous, and long drawn out. But as each passing year converts some of this experience into automatic routine, which we hardly note at all, the days and the weeks smooth themselves out in recollection to contentless units, and the years grow hollow and collapse." Maybe this is why kids are like often so excited around Christmas time and so easily caught up in the magic of the season. Maybe this is also why some adults just want to get past it all or talk about how the season feels too hectic and so busy. I mean, it used to be a big deal, but now we've become familiar with it, which means each year it may be little more than contentless units, and it can grow hollower and collapse just a little bit more. Because we have become familiar. Advent and Christmas are nostalgia, and this has the power to insulate us from what is right here and right now. It can remove us from the present moment. It's when we think like, yeah. I've been there, I've done that. But what if it's precisely in the midst of the normal, the mundane, right there in the middle of the ordinary, that we can actually catch a glimpse of the divine mystery? What if in the everyday pedestrian life, we can encounter the presence of God? What if right there in the familiar, there's an invitation to see a new way? I mean, just consider the divine encounters throughout the sacred text. It's not something that's planned. It's not during a church service. It's not a well-planned or executed spiritual practice during a weekend retreat. No, the divine encounters in the text happen smack in the middle of everyday life. In Genesis chapter 28, Jacob, the grandson of Abraham, lays down one night to sleep. While asleep, he has a dream where he sees a heaven opened and there's angels ascending and descending on a ladder, and God speaks to him and he wakes up, and both literally and figuratively he wakes up and he says, "Surely God was in this place and I was not aware of it." In Exodus chapter 3, we read of Moses tending sheep in the wilderness, and he sees a bush that's on fire but doesn't burn up, and he walks over, and as he approaches, God speaks to him saying, "Hey, remove your shoes because you're standing on holy ground." In 1 Kings chapter 19, Elijah's in the wilderness. He has no food and no water, and he thinks he's a dead man. And so he lies down and he falls asleep only to be awoken by an angel, and it's in that place he encounters the divine presence who feeds him and gives him water and tends to his needs. In Isaiah chapter 6, Isaiah has a vision where he sees God high and lifted up. And there's angels surrounding God saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And then God speaks to him and says, "Go and speak on my behalf to my people." We see this in Luke chapter 1, when an angel goes to this forgotten town called Nazareth, that's in the backwoods of a province on the distant edge of the Roman Empire, and there asks a teenage girl if she is up for what God has in mind. And we see this in the birth narrative. In Luke chapter 2, when the divine mystery comes to us as a newborn baby, we witness the life and light of the world, the animating energy that holds all things together, growing in the womb of a woman connected by his umbilical cord to a placenta, floating in amniotic fluid, entering this world through vaginal birth, crying out as he takes his first breath, as his central nervous system reacts to the sudden change in temperature and environment. He enters this world wholly dependent on the one who gave him birth, his mother, who we call Mary. And she's a teenage girl who's also vulnerable in her context. Now, she is dirt poor, and she bore the disgrace of being pregnant outside of marriage. This is who God entrusted God's life to. God entrusted its life to a young woman who would hold him, sing to him, wrap him tight to keep him warm, and rewrap him many times throughout the day. A mother who would awake in the middle of the night when he cried. A woman who fed the Savior of the world from her breast and nourished the Prince of Peace with milk her body produced. This is how God chose to put on flesh and enter this world of ours. Here in this story, we encounter the divine mystery as a helpless, scrawny, newborn child dependent on teenagers for his survival. This story tells us of the vulnerability, the risk that God took in this child. It is not just Emmanuel, it is not just God with us, it is God with us in the stark, naked, weak vulnerability of a newborn child. And I wonder, is it possible that if we take just a moment to contemplate this, it will be less ordinary and produce within us wonder and inspire awe. The vulnerability we observe at the very beginning of Jesus' life, by the way, it's a pattern that we see throughout his life. In Matthew chapter 25, there's a story that Jesus tells that we commonly call the sheep and the goats. And I want to read the first part of it to you, beginning in Matthew 25, verse 31. Jesus is speaking, and he says this, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' And then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' And the king will say to them, 'Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did to me.'" Jesus begins this story by speaking of the Son of Man. And it's important to note that Jesus often refers to himself throughout the Gospel of Matthew as the Son of Man. And it's in this context, then, that Jesus insists the Son of Man, that he is the one who's the recipient of the love and care. In this story, then, Jesus describes himself this way. He is hungry. He is thirsty. He is an immigrant. He is naked. He is sick. And he's incarcerated. And then he concludes the first part of the story by saying, whatever you did for the least of one of these brothers and sisters of mine, whatever you did for one of these siblings, you did it to me. Jesus points toward the most vulnerable people in his day, and he says, they are me. Where they are is where you will find me. This is not just God with us, but God with us in the vulnerability of hunger and thirst and poverty, sickness, immigration, and incarceration. What might happen if we take a moment to contemplate this? Might it produce within us wonder and inspire awe? We see this vulnerability again, by the way, in the book of Acts in chapter 9. Saul is on his way to arrest and hopefully in his mind kill followers of Jesus. They are on their run for their lives in the midst of a great persecution. And Saul is one of those leading the persecution. And he's on his way to Damascus. And when he's on his way, this light flashes around him and he hears a voice from heaven. And the voice from heaven says this, "Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." Notice Jesus doesn't say, "Why are you persecuting them?" or "Why are you picking on the weak?" No, Jesus identifies with the persecuted, those who are being arrested and imprisoned and executed. This, my friends, is not just Emmanuel. This is not just God with us. This is God with us in the persecution and arrest and in the loss of life at the hands of those in power. What might happen if we took a moment to contemplate this? Might it produce within us wonder and inspire awe? You see, this is the power of Jesus. It's his vulnerability seen clearly in the Christmas story. And maybe if we take a moment to contemplate this, we will be confronted with the beauty of this story, a story so simple that it actually has the power to break through the monotony in the familiarity and bring us face to face with a God who made God's self vulnerable. This not only tells us something about Jesus, it tells us something about the heart of the divine, because Jesus is the face of God. This is what Advent wants us to know. It wants us to know the risk, to see how far Jesus went, that even though he enjoyed equality with God, he set that aside and was knit together in the womb of a Mediterranean Jewish girl. All of this so that God could be near us and be known by us. This is the power of vulnerability. And not just here in Luke chapter 2, but throughout the life of Jesus. Because if we learn anything from his life, as it's recorded in the Gospels, it is that Jesus is to be found in weakness, in the margins, in the obscure and out of the way places, that Jesus is with and among the rejects, those who don't fit, those who don't belong, those who've been overlooked and forgotten. This is the hope, this is the power of Advent and Christmas. This is the wonder, a story that begins with amazement and awe. I mean, Christmas is in no way just another day. It declares God with us. God with us in the struggle, in the mess, in the pain. And not just God with us, but a God who experiences our struggles and mess and pain in the same way we do. God as one of us. And maybe as you watch or as you listen, you've asked in the mess of 2020, okay, great. Well, where is God? And Advent responds to that question by telling us God is with and among those hundreds of children who were and are separated from their parents at the border. God is in their fear, in their suffering, and in their tears, and in their anger, and in their wounds. When we say, where is God? Advent responds to that question by telling us that God is with and among those who live in fear, those considered suspicious, those who often feel small and invisible only because of the color of their skin. Advent responds to that question by telling us that God is with and among the kids who tell their parents that they're gay and they immediately get kicked out of their house and overnight they're in the streets. There, in that place, is where God is. Advent tells us that this is where God is with them. Advent responds to the question, where is God? By telling us that God is with and among our sisters, women who have been wounded because though they have gifts to share, they have been told that they cannot use them in the church only because of their gender. Advent responds to that question by telling us that God is with and among our friends experiencing homelessness, who are living in a safe outdoor space just outside this building, that God is found under the bridges and in the shelters. Advent responds to that question by telling us that God is with and among those who are addicted, that God is with and among those who are in ICU battling against COVID. That God is with and among those in Central America who've been devastated by two hurricanes. That God is with and among those who lost everything in the wildfires here in Colorado over the last several months. When we ask in exasperation, where is God? Advent responds to that question by telling us that God is with you, and God is with me, and God is with all of us. And it's not just Emmanuel. It's not just God with us. It's God with us in our disappointment, God with us in our heartache, in our grief, in our pain, in our uncertainty. God with us in our anger, in our wounds. God with us in our dirty little secrets. God with us in our shame, in our failure, in our sorrow. God with us in our suffering. It is God with us, coming to us as a vulnerable child, to be with us in all of our vulnerability. Luke tells us in his story in Luke chapter 2, the time came for a baby to be born, and Mary gave birth to her firstborn, a son. Which means, as we celebrate this story, Jesus is a baby. And again, I know this is obvious, but I think it bears repeating. And I think it bears repeating year after year after year, lest we ever forget God is with us. Lest we allow this story to become familiar and ordinary, and in doing so, fail to be undone by the wonder of it all. Let's pray together. God, I ask that we would never allow the vulnerability that you have taken on to become familiar, to become ordinary. May we not allow this story that we seem to know so well, this moment, this holy day, to become something for us that fails to produce wonder because we feel like we've been there and done that 100 times. May you always draw us into this story, reminding us of the naked, poverty-stricken vulnerability with which you entered this world. Would you remind us of the vulnerability that Jesus took on himself, the vulnerability he displayed in the places he stood and those with whom he stood, so that we would remember God is with us. We thank you and we praise you in awe and in wonder for this season, for this day, for this story. And we pray these things together in the week vulnerability of an infant, in whose name we pray. And all my friends online said, Amen.
We come to your table, Father God, desiring conversation and connection. Into this bread and this cup, we pour all of our joys and suffering, our hunger and satisfaction, our doubts and revelations, all beauty and all frustration. May these gifts sum up the whole human experience, all of our extremes offered to you for redemption in Christ Jesus. Now, while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many, for the forgiveness of sins." Now I invite you to take your bread and remember that this is Christ's body broken for you. And as you dip the bread in the wine or the juice, remember this is Christ's blood poured out for you. Amen. Wonderful to be with you today. As you leave this space, may you go now with this blessing. And now may you, my brothers and sisters, remember that God is with all of us, not just a few of us, all of us. Emmanuel does not show up to exert power over, but allows God's self to be in the midst of the most vulnerable. Peace be with you.